what the scene called for. And he was staying at the Chateau Marmont Hotel. The movie was being shot at MGM in Culver City. So I drove to Culver City, I drove to the Chateau Marmont, and I went to the desk and I said, I've been trying to reach him. I was trying for like a half hour, the lines were busy. He says, you can't go up. He told me nobody can come or go up to see him. He was speaking to his two daughters who were there, and some kind of emergency happened, and that's it. So I left a note and said, I'm here, and finished. Come on the set, we're waiting for you, no problem. Well, he came on the set around 12:30, and he started walking right towards me. And he said, Gruskov, from here on in, I'm carrying you on my back. Nothing to worry about. I'm taking over, you know, and then I laughed. And he was, you know, he was terrific. We shot a lot of the film in New York, and I'm from Brooklyn. So we shot scenes in Brooklyn, and we weren't too far from Coney Island. So we went to, I took him to Nathan's for a hot dog. And he had the hot dog, and there were people who looked at him. And he had done Lawrence of Arabia, you know, he's a major star, you know. What is he? And he was dressed in, you know, old clothes, you know, but old meat clothes. And there he was, Nathan, eating a hot dog. And we were shooting in an apartment house there. And all the Yentas were out there.
For those of you who don't know, Yenta is an old Jewish woman who gossips with her friends all the time. Now, so we got a nice little glimpse of your life as a producer, and before that you said you were an agent. Could you tell us, you know, from the long history, could you just give us, share one story that you feel comfortable sharing your years as an agent? Something...
Yeah, well, I worked for a company called CMA Creative Management, which after the biggest company, MCA, split up in 1962, two guys, David Bingham and Freddie Fields, started a company called CMA. And I started working for them in 64 and Freddie in 63. And Freddie was my mentor, actually. I loved him, great, great man. And so I learned a lot from him. And by the time, 4 or 5 years later, we were representing most of the stars in the business. You know, they all had come to us. And one day, somebody, one of the agents said, I understand that Jack Palance, James Coburn, is leaving his agent, a man named Maya Mishkin. And because Maya Mishkin, you know, handled Lee Marvin, James Coburn, Neville Brand, all these people that had, you know, played cowboys and, you know, but top, top tier actors. And we would never go to those people to rate them, you know, because if you're a smaller agent, you leave them alone. It's not the right thing to do. You wait for the client to want to leave, you know. So Coburn wanted to leave, and I had had dinner with him maybe two weeks before with Steve McQueen. They were good friends. And Steve said, you'll like it, you know. So we had dinner, and then we went over to Coburn's house, and we got high, and we had a good time. And so I was meeting, and they said, Coburn is going to this other agency, a big agency. I said, really? And it's like 9:30 in the morning. I said, well, I'm going to get up. You can't. And they said, well, the head agent that is flying in, he's signing papers with them tomorrow. So I get up, I call his house, and his wife, Beverly, answers the phone. And she's like, what the fuck are you calling me at 9:30 in the morning? You know, so, who are you? I said, yeah, then, oh, yes, yes. And I still have, and I work on her. And she says, okay, come over at 12 o'clock. So I go over at 12 because I wanted to, it was then or nothing, you know, and I liked him, he's a great guy. And she says, I go in, and the whole living room, bigger than this, is the couches, everything was set apart, and there's Coleman taking Kung Fu lessons with Bruce Lee, right in front of him. And Bruce Lee was not a big name at the time, you know. This was 1967 or 80. And there they're doing Kung Fu lessons, and I said, how long is this going to last? And she said, he'll be over in an hour, you know, so we're talking, and she said, you're crazy. I start telling them what we could do for him, which is we had the best directors there, and that's where it starts. And we had great contacts in the literary world, and before you know it, they finally said, okay, I'll meet Freddie Fields. They knew him, but they said, well, you guys are the mafia. You know what I mean? You guys, you start in 5 years, you have a big business, and the way you cut through it so fast. I said, well, cut through it for you. Just meet Freddie. So I get Freddie to, I go back to the office, and his assistant, Tony Howard, who's now a very big agent himself, says, okay, go in and see him. And he said, what happened? I tell him, you know, that with the mafia. So he calls Tony into the office, he says, go call Weston Costume. Get a shoulder holster and a pistol. You know, get a violin case. And go up and get contracts. With his name signed, you know, there. And put the contracts in the violin case. And put the violin case in my Bentley downstairs. I remember we're going to go there. So they agreed to see him at 7 o'clock. So 7 o'clock rolls along, and we're there, and they're waiting for us. And we're in the kitchen again, and we're drinking some wine, and we're talking. And then Freddie says, you know, it's kind of cool in here. Can we sit by the fire, you know? And they said, yeah. And then after 10, 15 minutes of talking, he says, I can take off my jacket. And they said, yes. And there it is, the shoulder holster in the system. After calling him the mafia. He says, we'll sign with you guys. It's enough already.